So welcome, everyone. I'm so excited for this day. Lots of us have been working on it for a while now, and I just want to start by just saying, you know, when I left the United States 11 years ago, and I landed myself in Oaxaca, Mexico, southern Mexico, incredibly beautiful place, incredibly poor place, and I had just finished mapping the ecosystem that we were calling then the social capital markets. And Kevin and I then were, with others, had the idea because of the mapping project to start SOCAP. And 7 years later, here we are, and it's amazing. But when I got there, somebody had told me, you should talk to a guy named Rodrigo Villar. So I did. Maybe after a year or so, I met Rodrigo Villar. And Rodrigo was sitting in an office by himself, and he later told me he had about $70,000 a year as a budget. And he was like, let's do something together. Let's collaborate. Let's, you know, really open and warm and embracing. Well, it took another 5 years before we started working together. But I was able to watch from where he started, from scratch, and in 8 or 9 years, do amazing things. For instance, he created probably the best and more mature accelerator in the space. He co-created the first green pages for green businesses in Mexico. He created the first SOCAP-like event in Mexico. And then he created a fund, a $20 million fund with his partner, Eric, in just 8 years. And then I want to talk to you about Marianne Cortina. She's 27, 28 years old. And she was in the position of having to help run her father's business after he became ill. So she got mature really quickly. But she said to Tony Carr from Halloran one time, she said, our generation is going to change the world. And Mexico's going to kick ass. And I want to talk to you about Javier Terrell. Javier climbed the ladder at Colgate, being eventually the number two person internationally. He left. He's now on the international boards of Starbucks, JCPenney, and Nielsen. And he also started an impact fund called Spectrum, with his daughter and his son. And finally, I just want to tell you about two amazing mothers, Norma and Maria, from Ochimba. It's a place in Oaxaca that most Oaxaqueños don't know where it is. And with the help of their community and Barefoot College, They were sent to India for 6 months. They hadn't been out of the region before. And they were surrounded by other mothers and women that were learning to become solar panel engineers. And now they're back in their village, installing solar panels and lighting up their village for the first time. And they say they're going to do it by December. I said, why December? Because we want light for Christmas. I just wanted to give you some grounding as to some of the people that are out in front of this movement in Mexico, but some of the people that are invisible but are so strong behind. And part of the reason we're here is to share the dynamism that's here, but also why Mexico might be a really great place for lots of people, lots of investors, lots of partnerships, a lot of people to come and participate. So with that, we're going to show a short video that kind of gives us a little bit more grounding. Okay, we're going to show a video.
Mexico is a big country with a huge social opportunity. Total population is 117 million people, from which 53 million live in poverty. A poor family earns less than $180 per month. Areas of social opportunity proliferate in many sectors. Mexico is the 11th world economy in terms of GDP and the second in Latin America. Mexico counts with 11 free trade agreements with 43 countries. The foreign direct investment in Mexico from January to March 2014 raises to $5,820.8 million, 16.7% more than the same period of 2013. There's an increasing potential for growth of the Mexican economy due to some important and long overdue reforms in key strategic sectors, notably in the energy sector. Many organizations are seeing impact investing as a natural ally to government and philanthropy to find solutions for a big social opportunity. The Entrepreneur Fund, managed by the National Institute of Entrepreneurs, has a budget of $721 million for 2014, 20% more than 2013. Today, we are more than 150 organizations working collaboratively to move impact investment forward in Mexico. Mexican impact investing ecosystem is still in its early days. We estimate that only $100 million have been invested in impact investing in Mexico so far. In total, we have about 70 social enterprises in impact investing portfolios, most of them in early stage. But we are seeing dramatic growth for the next few years. Impact investing is already 35% of the venture capital in Mexico. For 2014 alone, investors have allocated $50 million for impact investing, 50% of total invested. We estimate available capital for impact investing to be around $700 million for the next 5 years. In only 5 years, we have seen the number of accelerators and incubators multiply by 10 to the current 40. These will create a pipeline of more than 500 social entrepreneurs in 2014. Education institutions are seeding entrepreneurship. Social entrepreneurship is in the curriculum in every major university. Prizes and opportunities are flourishing, and we expect to have more than 30,000 social entrepreneurs applying to open calls.
Mapping the ecosystem with the GMAP tool led us to know that today we have $50 million available for impact investing in Mexico. Regionalizing this effort is one of the top priorities of the sector. Also this year, we're launching the National Impact Investing Association to articulate all the efforts from many different stakeholders in the country. And finally, very glad to say that many investors are supporting strongly all kinds of efforts and initiatives to foster social entrepreneurship. Thank you.
Foundations are taking an active and leading role in impact investing. We have moved from pure philanthropy to venture philanthropy. We are developing the social entrepreneurs pipeline by launching new programs and platforms to inspire and support them. We're bringing together all resources and actors to join us.
We want to create a bond between the social entrepreneurs and the products and services that they are offering and the demands that the industry are requiring. And we want to create a bond between them, and in order to do this, we want to use the leverage of the private industry.
Today, New Ventures Mexico, together with many other partners, are doing a great movement called the Latin American Impact Investing Forum, FLI. The main idea is to consolidate the system, bring new actors, and make impact investing much more important and relevant in Mexico and Latin America.
I have been involved in the social entrepreneurs ecosystem in Mexico since 2009, and I had the chance to organize the first FLI in Mérida, Yucatán. And I can tell you that I have never seen this community growing faster. And it's amazing how you can find events to find the perfect partner, a mentor, or simply to share your failure or your success. Almost every night, there's always activity in the ecosystem. It's growing really fast, and it's getting stronger.
Co-working spaces in Mexico are an exciting addition to our ecosystem. We're bringing together entrepreneurs, innovators, partners, government, academia, in order to have that pipeline to have a better impact socially, environmentally, and economically. We're doing this through creating innovative spaces and offering workshops and events and networking to really build that bridge between people and impact.
I think it's very important to empower the social entrepreneurs. I think to provide a platform where they can come and collaborate and synergize their ideas and their projects is very valuable. For example, the prizes and the awards that are being given around the country in Mexico are a wonderful space for them to come together, get to know each other, be empowered, and for their projects to be known by many more people.
I think it's critical to continuously incentivize organizations to reach beyond their own impact and work together as an ecosystem in order to provide and facilitate an environment that is good for entrepreneurial growth.
Women and men that believe in the power of businesses to change Mexico are building the ecosystem that supports social entrepreneurs, making it spicier.
Okay, I think you guys are probably getting a sense for what's happening in Mexico. A couple of housekeeping things before we start. We're doing a poll. Leti's going to put some information on the screen about how you can participate in the poll. No? So you text, what number, Leti? Sorry? At MexSOCAP, just follow at MexSOCAP Twitter, and you can participate in the poll and participate in guiding the conversation. Also, there's a fuck-up nights tonight at 4, right, Leti? 5. And a Mexican party at the Firehouse Theater, the Firehouse Building, which is the furthest building on that side, at 7:30. So I told everybody here, I want a real conversation today. I haven't told who I'm, who's going to go when, and I encourage you guys just to jump in because this is real and it's exciting, and there's challenges as well. And one of the things that really helped us, I think, in the United States, or at least the group of involved with SOCAP and the Hub Network here and others, was a mapping exercise that we did. Montse has been one of the leaders taking responsibility for this and making it happen, along with Pedro and others, Promotora Social. So I think it's worthwhile to start with the mapping exercise, and maybe you could share a couple of the things that stood out that maybe surprised you, or some areas of weakness as well.
Well, you can see that we have like 4 posters over here. You will find there like most of our findings there, but maybe what I want to share is 3 ideas that come up from our mapping exercise. So we did that 1.5 years ago, and it was a group of us, impact investors, accelerators, incubators in Mexico, that were wondering how big was the movement. One, and second, what we needed to do to make it even bigger. So basically we use GMAP, that's a social mapping network that happens basically all online, that it was very powerful for us. And we were surprised by 3 things. First one is how much collaboration people wanted to put on the plate. In very few days, we got 17 organizations funding for the exercise. And in very short period of time, we got 800 organizations in GMAP expressing themselves with interest in impact investing in Mexico. That was the first thing that it was really interesting. The second thing was getting to the real numbers about how big we are. And so even Mexico is not a big country in terms of private equity yet. So we are like 15 times smaller than the States in private equity in general numbers. We discovered that impact investing is already 35% of venture capital in Mexico. So we discovered that over the last 5 years, about $100 million have been invested in impact investing in Mexico. And we discovered that the 16 funds or investing organizations that are more active in Mexico now have available $50 million to invest only this year, $50 million. And we estimate that the capital committed for the next 5 years is going to be around $1 billion. So that's something. So if you compare to the amounts that we were talking this morning in the panel, it's something for Mexico. It's about, so if in the world, I think the Gene is talking about 10 billion now committed, we are talking about 1 billion near only for Mexico. So this told us about that it's an incredible interest about helping this social opportunity that you saw in the video, and to bridge the gap that we are having with government and philanthropy, not being able alone to cope with the problem. And then there was a third thing that it's not so good news, but it really helped us to move together to fill that gap. So we discovered that we had a big gap, that it was, we were not having enough bridges to tell social entrepreneurs or young people that this is a possibility. And whereas we are about 150 companies trying to help entrepreneurs, we only invested in 70. So 150 companies, 70 entrepreneurs. So something is not working, right? So for the last 1 year and a half, there has been lots of initiative, in part thanks of the mapping exercise, to bridge that gap. So we have seen many new accelerators coming, at least 5-6 of them. So we increased the capacity to incubate and accelerate social entrepreneurs by at least fivefold. We have much more ways for colleges and universities to have in their programs something about social entrepreneurship. You will see the numbers in the charts if you are interested, but that's the third learning that we had, that we need to work collaboratively to bridge that gap, that it's more building that infrastructure, okay?
Yeah, just to add to that, we did a startup weekend. I didn't do it, it just appeared on the landscape. I was asked to be a judge, and 130 people, 130 young university-aged kids showed up. And when we sat down to judge, there were about 16, 17 different projects, and 80% were social. You know, Startup Weekend isn't, nobody said, hey, let's do a social Startup Weekend. It's just, I think, kind of ingrained in Mexico, in the way people think. Hey, Rafa, so Omidyar's been in this space, one of the early participants in this whole landscape internationally. And I'm wondering why Mexico, why did Omidyar decide to start playing a role in Mexico?
Sure. Thank you. I mean, I want to talk about the need because I think we've seen some of the figures there. I think it's important, like, there's a real need in Mexico. There's a lot of people under the national poverty line, maybe not under the $1 or $2 a day that is like the flagship that a lot of the development organizations look for, but there's a real need there. And I think there's a scarce philanthropic funds in the country, at least in, you know, organizations that are a bit more innovative and that are not just building a dwell or a school or something like that. So I think for us, we saw a very clear need. By the time we entered, levels of entrepreneurial activity were very high, but there was not that many early stage risk capital targeting this sector. So I think that was very, very important. But I think most important, like the opportunity. I think there's certain things that countries like Mexico have that, you know, our presence in sub-Saharan Africa, in India, you don't find that. Everyone talks about willingness to pay. And willingness to pay is important, but capacity to pay is more important. And I think in all Latin America, but particularly Mexico, what we see is this aspiring middle class, this vulnerable class that it's maybe middle income in terms of like their income levels, but is nowhere near being middle class. They lack a safety network. They lack access to products and services that, as I was saying, they want to purchase. So I think there's a very big opportunity in a lot of the sectors that we serve. People want better financial services. People want better education for their kids. Moving from just emergency healthcare to preventive healthcare. So I think there's a very, at the macro level, there's a very big opportunity, and there's other certain things that make it like very attractive for investors like us. It's a large market, it's fairly close to the US, and it still gets a lot of the innovation coming from Central and South America. So I think for us made like a lot of natural sense. And I think to your point, Monse, it's amazing. I moved to Mexico City 5 years ago, and by the time I joined, like it was New Ventures Mexico and some other pioneers right there. And now there's really a lot of people pushing this movement forward. Maybe too many, but so I think it's a really, really exciting place to test not just the BOP, the based of the pyramid models, but models that are for this aspiring middle class, for this middle of the pyramid that is really hungry for proper products and services. And a lot of the corporations have been traditionally focused in that top 15-20% with a credit card. So I think that plus the existing infrastructure that I think like government has a very big footprint in Mexico, and you can leverage that, or companies like FEMSA that can like really like help you with your distribution because they have presence in every single village in the country. I think that's something that you don't see necessarily in other emerging markets.
I think maybe I want to ask Javier because to sort of ground the discussion in, you know, a challenge, a particular challenge, in this case diabetes, which is the number one killer in Mexico of all categories, and the innovation that's arising there. Javier, just like a little, you know, background on what you're doing, how you're approaching the problem, and why.
Great. Well, thanks everyone, and feels great to be around so many incredible people here. So pretty happy to be here. So Clínicas del Azúcar, or Sugar Clinics, is a low-cost, one-stop shop for diabetes care. And as you mentioned, Mark, diabetes is a catastrophe in Mexico. It's the number one cause of death, number one cause of amputations, blindness, kidney failure, and even suicides. More than 30% of the people that try to commit suicides is because of the lack of diabetes care. So why our approach is so different. So usually, as we know, Mexico, you have two Mexicos. One, it's the rich part of Mexico that usually have access to private care, expensive endocrinologists, and even saturated with this market. And then you have the 85% or 90% of the rest of the population that relies on government health centers. So either you have money to pay private care or just very limited care. And what I realized was the first thing is endocrinologists will never work hard to find a solution for low-income people because they are really like looking into how can I make my practice much better, how can I tackle these segment problems. And also, usually endocrinologists lead the discussions on diabetes care. And my surprise was, in talking and having a discussion with a few of them, I mean, their perspective of the market is these 2 or 5% of the population. So they make the decisions, the public policies based on these only few people. And then you have the government with all the challenges in how to provide care for millions of people. So our solution was, and I like it to say, it's kind of like, I know it's ironic, but our idea was we need to make the McDonald's of diabetes. It's very affordable, convenient, high-tech, automated centers for diabetes care. If you today, and we have FEMSA here, if you want to buy a Coke, I mean, it takes like 2-3 minutes. You go to an OXXO, get a Coke, and that's it. And it's in every corner. But if you want to get diabetes care, it's so complicated. I mean, just to make an appointment, 2-3 weeks later, you get one. It's so expensive. It's confusing. So we are trying and making a solutions very convenient so people can just walk in, walk out very easily and have a convenient and very affordable diabetes care. And so our approach was very different in terms of technology, process improvement, automated processes, and a different payment scheme, understanding how low-income people could pay for that. So we create an annual fixed fee that where everything is included for that.
So Javier has an amazing board of experienced business people, and I've heard in our conversations, Rafa, that you're one of the things that you're suggesting is that there are still some missing actors, including experienced business people and maybe more connections to the supply chain. But can you comment about what you think?
I mean, I think like in terms of the ecosystem, as we were saying, it has moved a lot. And I think it has been a lot of focus on getting the word out there. But I think the word is out there. I mean, if 35% of the venture capital funds self-define as impact investing funds, if we have 40 accelerators, I think we just need to start having a bit more gray hair. I don't think we need more competitions. I don't think we need more kind of like accelerators run by people like me that have never run a business before, or more marketing or more events. So I think that's the only thing. I think as ecosystem players, when I look at like government and foundations, are we actually disrupting the market? Are we kind of creating a lot of incentives for people to start a small social business or run another competition or do another event? And I think it's kind of like as actors, and like we should start thinking about how can we start making more connections with people like FEMSA or with people like, you know, Pemex has a gas station everywhere. That can be a distribution channel. How can we help entrepreneurs really leverage all the potential that there's in Mexico, and I think build truly scalable models versus, you know, one-off stories that we love to tell in, you know, the hip bar in Condesa when we are all together, but that really are relying on, you know, small donations from one foundation or like a small grant from government or things like that. So I think, you know, there's so many business to business opportunities, and we have in our audience people are working with corporations to, you know, improve hiring in Mexico. That is a huge bottleneck. Or really, like, I think I would like to see more focus as ecosystem and as investors in driving people toward that collaboration with government, collaboration with big corporations, leveraging that versus doing the next kind of copycat B2C cool model that someone has heard from the US or like another really small initiative that is really never gonna replicate. But I mean, I think we're moving towards that direction.
Well, that's, of course, I'm gonna talk to Francisco because I think Francisco's and FEMSA moving in that direction pretty quickly. But Francisco, maybe you can just tell me a little bit about, you know, how the sustainability piece of FEMSA came together and what you're doing and maybe a little bit about the supply chain play that I think you're making.
Okay, well, Mark, thank you for the interest in Mexico and Oaxaca especially. We need much more Marks in Mexico to get things moving. Before, I don't mind to just make some initial information of FEMSA important, of the culture of the company. Started in 1890 with a bunch of young entrepreneurs with a social vision, and they have been pioneers in social investment. Before it was a law to have medical services or housing, the company started with this, and then the CEO back in the 40s started Teca Monterrey with a vision to, you know, to have educated communities that also going to help your company go forward. So when the company decided in 2011 to start the sustainability area, they gave us an opportunity to be entrepreneurs in this new venture for the company, investing more focused in different items. One of the first, I think, was a really good marriage we had was with Achoca. And it was in 2011, we started through the program Avancemos, a program that's youth with value. So it's really focused on youth between 14 and 24. We have been investing a lot on that. It's a program that already has about 320 projects in 3 states in Mexico. But that was kind of the first feeling for us to start tasting how to help the entrepreneur ecosystem in Mexico. The impact investing analysis or mapping was really helpful because there was a lot of actors working in Mexico, not that many working to promote the new ideas. And then there was a lack of a bridge with the offer that the entrepreneurs have with a market. So that's our connection with the supply chain. And so with that in mind, we had some idea that, okay, it makes sense to work on the continue working with Youth with Value, with Achoca, and start building new alliances. Well, we did an alliance with the Impact Hub in Monterrey, with the pool in Mexico, and started helping the more advanced stages of the entrepreneurs project to help them go forward. So that's what's been a really good understanding. We're piloting the concept in Mexico, and fortunately, things are moving for us. And FEMSA is like this next, hopefully, big social investment we're doing, and we would like to take this to other countries. We made a commitment with Clinton Global Initiative to support 520 projects. In the next 4 years, it's an investment about $4.5 million. And we're still learning. I think it has been a really interesting journey. The team here, Jose, and a lot of young, enthusiastic, energetic team has been building the alliances to help also help help the entrepreneurs. FEMSA is not just only giving the finance to help the entrepreneurs. The network that FEMSA has of over 50,000 suppliers, the executives' talent are also helping the entrepreneurs with their knowledge in the day-to-day. We have volunteers and mentors that we're using to connect with our network, and also the talent of retired executives to also help the entrepreneurs. Also, something that's important is the leverage that FEMSA has to help connect the new entrepreneur with the market. And at the end, that's some of the examples how we've been evolving the past 3-4 years. And the question you asked me about our supply chain, we have done other sorts of alliances or supported events such as the Clean Tech Challenge, where we have some examples of the winners that are now suppliers of FEMSA, with Teca Monterrey, IDB, Walmart, Banorte, we started another program working with 3,000 suppliers in Mexico to help them have green, training and the ways to get investments, finance for their projects. And well, there's a lot, the pool we have connected some of the projects with OXXO, with the Impact Hub in Monterrey, some of the projects that were youth with value are now in the hub and connecting with some of our business units. So we're really trying to connect and build a bridge between the entrepreneurs and the market.
So I went to, last weekend I was part of Unreasonable Mexico. So Unreasonable Institute has an amazing accelerator in Boulder, and they've decided to do two experiments, one in Uganda and one in Mexico. And I was in a dorm room with seven other people, like, but that is the style, like you go and it's like you're in a frat house and like helping mentor the 11 entrepreneurs that were there. And Pepe told me this really funny thing, because I think it's really interesting. Particularly with big companies, he said, like, at first, Pepe's from FEMSA, he said, at first we were like the elephant was right here, and we pushed and pushed, and we could feel something moving, but we didn't know if it was just the skin of the elephant that was moving. But eventually, they're starting to see the elephant move themselves, and I think that the model of bringing an accelerator of social entrepreneurs, a marriage of the grassroots up inside a big company that gets connected to a supply chain is brilliant. And if FEMSA can do that and act as a role model for others, Mexico's gonna have, and I am seeing, I think, the corporate community kind of grabbing this faster than maybe even in the United States. So Jorge, we just talked very recently, yesterday, not even talked, but emailed some ideas back and forth, and your background's really interesting. At a very young age, you seem to have found a way to do some good things for your country, but the thing that stuck out, obviously, to me was the work of Mexico in Silicon Valley, and you've been immersed in the ecosystem here, and I'm wondering if you could sort of talk about your work a little bit, but also maybe draw some parallels to what you see in Silicon Valley as an ecosystem and what's emerging in Mexico.
Of course. Well, first of all, thank you everybody for coming here. I'm the Mexican consul in Silicon Valley. I'm the person who designed and implemented Mexico's strategy for entrepreneurship here in the Valley. Well, there's a lot of things to talk about. First of all, the Mexican government started talking with the U.S. about how can both countries come up with a binational strategy to promote entrepreneurship, because both of the economies are so deeply intertwined that whatever happens to one economy has a ripple effect to the other. So here in California, the high-tech industry and Silicon Valley has been a very powerful economic drive force. And Mexico recognized that and identified it. So President Obama traveled in 2013 to visit President Peña Nieto, and they have a very interesting discussion about how they could both promote entrepreneurship as a North American economic drive force. And they came up with something that is called the U.S.-Mexico Entrepreneurship Innovation Council. And this council is composed of both members from the U.S. and Mexico, and they came up with a series of strategies at the national level from both countries to start implementing to create an entrepreneurship ecosystem that would benefit the region. So as part of this initiative, there were discussions of increased lending from the banks, of increasing opportunities for entrepreneurs, and the Mexican government decided to start focusing on human capital development. And in order to do that, the ultimate goal was to direct Mexico into the high-tech industry and create a knowledge economy. So our consulate has been running a pilot program among the 51 consular missions in the U.S. And in order to create these human capital development programs. And what we are doing is we are creating a network of entrepreneurs. We're bringing Mexican entrepreneurs into the Silicon Valley ecosystem, and the goal is to have 100,000 of them by the year 2018. So it's a very ambitious goal. It's our ambassador in Washington, D.C., he's making an extraordinary effort. And we've been touching base with the private sector, the universities, and the public sector in order to create, to make this possible. So we started by scholarships, and when we bring here entrepreneurs, we get them immersed into several top level programs. Just about a month ago, we have 30 entrepreneurs who had a chance of talking with the professor of Larry Page and Sergey Brin at Stanford. And they had a chance of going to NASA's Ames Research Center. And now they're working in 3D printers for dental prosthetics in places that can create a social impact for millions of people. So the government strategy is there. And of course, we're pouring investment. We're opening the bank system through its associations, and it's still going to take time. It's very difficult to see results through the political reforms in a very short phase. But Mexico is in an excellent position right now.
So is that right? We have 10 minutes left. Five. Okay, we're going to have to continue this conversation tonight at the party. You're going to have to all come so we can all get involved. Mezcal and tequila. Do we have a microphone for the audience? Because I don't want to leave without having the opportunity. Does anyone have a question? Do we need a microphone? Yeah, here we go.
Hi, my name is Sean Paul with ReInventure Capital. I just want to commend you on a great panel. As this panel in part is seeking to attract over international investment to Mexico, could you respond to sort of an obvious perception of issue of a legal framework, violence, safety, security? Why are you thriving, and why should international investors feel assured, given the political context?
Okay. Well, Mexico, of course, it's a very big country, and it has a lot of problems. And we've been working on precisely most security over the past years. No, fortunately enough, security has been improving dramatically throughout the country. There are specific areas in which there's still caution to be taken. But in terms of legal requirements, it's so easy to work in Mexico. Just to put you in the right context, for Tesla's Gigafactory that was being considered here is being considered here in California, it's more complicated than to put that Gigafactory in Texas. Or for Apple campus, it took about a year and a half just to go through all the legal paperwork. In Mexico, it's basically only two legal requirements. It's basically the equivalent of the IRS and having a business license. So obviously at the corporate level, having environmental policies is not as painfully as it is currently in California. So it's very legal friendly, especially now with all of the political reforms that are being implemented currently. In the energy sector, just for example, it's being open now. It's something that we've never seen in so many years. So it's a fantastic opportunity to create a competition and pour into so many challenges that the energy sector faces.
Francisco, I think you wanted to...
Yeah. Obviously, besides the good job that the past government and the current government is doing security-wise and reforms, et cetera, I just would point out the Mexican entrepreneurs are incredible, the level of innovation they have. And if you take in what we've been working in states such as Michoacan and Veracruz, Nuevo León also, you know, it's been a complicated past 3-4 years. If you just take in mind the normal path of an entrepreneur to survive, it's, you know, complicated. The resilience that the Mexican entrepreneurs have, additionally, surviving the different contexts we just talked about, makes them to have a better premium in the market. So if I would be an investor, I would put a premium on the Mexican entrepreneurs, yes, but the additional variables they have to survive. And again, the Mexican government is doing a great job on that, but you will have really good entrepreneurs in the moment they go to market.
Maybe a way to phrase that is, and I want to remind something that Rafa said. Spectron is an investor. We are an impact investor in Mexico. Besides, we did the GMAP and all this stuff, but our true nature is being investors. And if there is one thing that we want to see more, is more experienced people than us, because we are innovating. We are so happy that Halloran is by our side and others. So we will do anything to have people like you to come and co-invest with us. And maybe a good way to start is just having a local partner to help you guide, like, the legal environment, the security environment, and to for you to be more reassured that Mexico is a safe place to invest. So.
Just very, very quickly, there is a new legal or corporate structures. About 7 years ago, they created the SAPI structures where shareholders can have voting rights, and so it's now very secure for investors, international and national. And two, we have been operating in very low-income areas of Monterey, and so far, I mean, we haven't had any issue with terms of violence, for example. And just I want to mention how also talent is becoming very, very important in Mexico. Two examples, the former CEO of Cerveceria, a huge brewery from FEMSA, he's an angel investor of us, and the time he's devoting to us, and even I got a conversation with him a couple months ago, and he's like, how can I make my kids and my sons like kind of like start these kind of businesses? And to me it was shocking, because maybe he was like, he's a role model for his sons, and he's saying, no, I want my sons to go into impact investing, much better than a corporate career. And the other is, we just brought in Miguel Garza, who's here, Booz and Company consultant, MBA from Wharton, and he decided to quit his job and come to join Clínicas del Azúcar and say, how we scale. So that's something also really amazing that you're seeing in Mexico, having these people coming from corporate, big jobs, now saying, how can I go to startups? And that's also a big shift and important to investors, because we know that you have the experience, the not only the innovator, but also people with experience in management to scale these companies.
So we're gonna have to end. I just wanna say a couple of things. One is that it's clear to me almost every Mexican's an entrepreneur, and has had like 10 startups before they've been 20 years old, probably. But that, which is really important, it's not even under the name of entrepreneurship. Is maybe in some cases it's just survival. But the other thing is, like in Oaxaca, after being there for 11 years, and like it was really, if you ask most Mexicans, I think, like, what's the strongest part of Mexico? They'll say family, and I in Oaxaca, I was always trying to figure out how would that bond that's within the family structure, how could you take that outside of the family structure? And what I've come to realize is that all of the organizations and the ecosystem of Mexico that's arising right now is that family, and it's an amazing thing to watch. So anyway, thank you everybody for being here, and thank you guys.